So let's go through that video again. I'm gonna start talking about like the pathophys of electrical injury. There's a lot of details to it. I'll try to only cover things that will be helpful. This video, surprisingly, will help cover pretty much everything. So, start at the beginning. Right here. So you see here, it's got like the mechanics of electricity. There's AC, DC, and there's low voltage, high voltage. AC is like electrons moving back and forth in a current at a certain frequency. That's actually thought to be more dangerous, and that's the type of electricity everyone has in their houses, it's in buildings, it's in plugs. AC current actually leads to more complications. It's more likely to give you an arrhythmia. DC is just a direct flow of electrons. That's a little less dangerous, but that's something you'll see with like power lines or third rails. And then you see down here the voltages. Low voltage is kind of arbitrarily defined as less than 1,000. That's going to be in houses, like plugs are 240 to 120. The only high voltage things really are power lines, and I think third rails are high voltage. So most of what we'll see is low voltage, but it's good to know. So, let's say he's AC low voltage. So right there, first thing that happens with AC voltage or AC electricity low voltage, you get tetanic contractions. So this is a real thing, like when someone grabs onto something and it's an AC circuit, their flexors will be fired and your flexors are stronger than your extensors, so you'll just be grabbing onto that thing and that causes you to hold onto it for longer. So right here, we can imagine he's going into some sort of cardiac arrhythmia. Probably V-fib, or low voltage is more likely to put you in V-fib. High voltage is more likely to give you asystole, so let's imagine he's going into V-fib right now. Still on low voltage. So, other thing that low voltage will do for you, he's been on there for a little bit, it's pretty hot, you get superficial burns. It's just like any other burn, it's the skin. Those are the real main things that happen with low voltage. Maybe he's having a little bit of respiratory rest, your chest wall muscles will contract from the electricity, and you'll stop breathing. See here, you get switched over to high voltage. So let's pretend that went above 1,000. So now, probably asystole as opposed to V-fib. Keep going. It's probably going into rhabdo right now. That's one of the main problems with high voltage electricity. You get these deep burns, and they actually go, it's not just superficial, they go through the muscles, they cause like vascular leak that cause some muscle necrosis. You get pretty significant rhabdo. And that's the deep burns. He's got the burns all the way through. It's not just on his skin. It's like kind of causing necrosis deep down inside. And then the last kind of injury that is associated with electricity is trauma. So people will get flung, they'll fall, they'll hit their head. Like he does. So, cardiac and burns are the main thing. You get, while you're getting electrocuted, you're usually going to V-fib or asystole, and then afterwards you can have cardiac arrhythmias. Most common things you'll see in the ER, I'll go over later. You can have the respiratory rest from the contraction of the muscle wall, the chest wall. You can have the superficial burns, so this would be more of like a low voltage injury. Superficial burn treated just like any other burn. Deep burns are more like the form of black Escher, and you won't necessarily see extensive burns, and you might think it looks okay, but that should actually be more worrying to you. People go into rhabdo from the deep burn injury of the muscles. And then you can also get compartment syndrome, you get the vascular leak, you get the muscle injury. And then you can have CNS damage. It's not really something we're too concerned about. You get loss of consciousness, but a lot of people can get delayed injury, like spinal cord problems, but that's not something we'll really deal with in the ER. So what are we going to do? Let's say someone comes in with a high voltage electrical injury, they'll probably just be a trauma patient. They'll come in, they'll be sick. We'll be doing everything for them, so we'll be doing ACLS, ATLS. If they're in some sort of arrhythmia, we'll do ACLS. We'll look for all of their injuries. These people can have like trauma from a fall, they can have TM rupture, they can have vascular injury, compartment syndrome, all these things. One thing you do want to think about with electrical injuries in particular is rapid. So you want to aggressively fluid hydrate these people, like just hang 2 liters on them and let them go wide open. And then they are, for the most part, burn patients. So here we don't have a burn center, so we probably end up transferring them. And then as far as diagnostics, this is more for like a low voltage. Let's say someone comes in and they say, I shocked myself on a plug in my own house. It's a low voltage injury. They look okay. You're definitely going to want to do an EKG. That's the thing you'll do on everybody. Common things you'll see are like right bundle branch block versus 380 block, maybe just sinus tachycardia. All of those are technically arrhythmias, so that's worrying that something happened to their heart. You want to do a CK and a UA, make sure you identify any rhabdo going on, UA, you're looking for myoglobinuria, and then just your normal trauma imaging. If they fell and hit their head, you want to do a CT head, you want to have them in a C collar so you can clear it, etc. Those are kind of the basic things. And then you'll also probably be sending off your basic labs. And then dispo, this is also more of an issue for low voltage injuries. High voltage, it'll either be admit or transfer to a burn center. So you're going to do your initial assessment and give them IV fluids. For low voltage injuries, there's a lot of studies that say if they have no, like they're conscious, they didn't have an arrhythmia at the time, they didn't like black out, and then they have a normal EKG and they feel well, they can just go home. So someone stuck their fingers in a plug, they feel fine now, their EKG is normal, you can send them home. If they have an arrhythmia, you'll probably have to admit them. High voltage, it's pretty much, are they going to go to a burn center or not? So you have to make that decision based on their exam. Special circumstances, so we might see people coming in who've been tasered. Tasers have actually found to be not dangerous at all, as far as like cardiac arrhythmias and like long-term sequelae. The main injuries are from those little things shooting into you. You can get a pneumothorax, and you have to take them out of the patient, it hurts. But you don't really have to monitor them, you can just send them back to wherever they came from. And then, like we were talking about earlier, kids who bit an electrical wire. So I actually read that you're supposed to admit these people because they have the labial artery right here. And they might have this like scarring over it initially, and then as soon as that heals, the labial artery will start bleeding. So I read that you're supposed to admit them and monitor them for a couple of days, have the surgeon see them, and just make sure they don't start bleeding. That wasn't the answer to that question.
So the only thing is that usually when they bleed the most is when the eschar starts to come off.
Yeah.
And that takes days.
Okay.
So if a lot of people now feel that if you have a good home situation and you can arrange for good plastic surgery follow-up, we're going to need plastic surgery eventually to fix that, that it might be better for the baby to be sent home and to be watched closely at home. And if there's any evidence that, well, they start to bleed, the parents put pressure on you, call the MS staff, rather than keeping them in the hospital up to 10 days.
Okay, that makes sense.
But it again depends on the home situation.
Yeah.
How safe you feel it is and what follow-up you can get.
Yeah. Last thing I want to talk about is lightning. Lightning's very, very high voltage DC current. Lightning is interesting in that it's either you're going to die from a lightning strike or there's like a 100% survival. So you do a reverse triage. So my thing, if somebody is not immediately dead from a lightning strike, they're probably going to survive. But with like a lightning strike, let's say there's a mass casualty lightning strike, you want to reverse triage so the people that look like they're already dead, those are the people you go to first because they either are in some sort of arrhythmia, they're like a young, healthy person, CPR will do well for them, you put on the cardioverting pads and do ACLS and it'll usually have good outcomes, or they just have respiratory muscle contraction, and so they're just in respiratory arrest, so you just bag them for a little while until they come back. And people are not still charged electrically when they get struck by lightning, so you can go touch them. Lightning prevention, essentially all I read was just don't be outside. Don't stand near trees, don't stand in open fields, don't stand near tall things, don't stand by yourself, just don't be outside. Okay, so the main points here, high voltage electrical injuries or traumas, they'll probably be pretty straightforward, they'll come in, you'll be working them up forever.